Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah. You are audible, Anuj.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. I, Abhinav Singh, on behalf of the seminar committee of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, National Law University, welcome you all to this inaugural ceremony of National Seminar on Law and Technology Issues in Perspective. Now, this seminar is an endeavor to invite views from cross-sections of the stakeholders on legal issues relating to technology and to widen the awareness about the interconnection of law and technology, both in the legal field and the society. Now, this seminar is a two-day event with almost five technical sessions. Participants shall present their research work during the technical session. Now, I welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor Dr. Subir K. Bhatnagar, without whose blessings and gratitude, this event would not even be possible. I would also like to use this opportunity to welcome our chief guest for today, Professor Dr. Tabriz Ahmed, Vice Chancellor of GD Goenka University, our guest of honor, Professor Triveni Singh, SP Cybercell UP Police, our keynote speaker, Advocate Apar Gupta, Executive Director of Internet Freedom Foundation. I also welcome our head of department, Professor Dr. Sanjay Singh, and Dr. Prem Kumar Gautam, the chairperson of the seminar committee. I would like to thank everyone for taking out their valuable time for today's session. Now, without any further delay, I would like to invite our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to kindly say a few words and inaugurate today's event. Sir.
Good morning. I welcome all of you to this very important seminar on law and technology. Professor Tabriz Ahmed Saab, grateful to you that you have accepted our invitation to be the chief guest. I welcome you, sir. Then Mr. Apar Gupta, a well-known advocate, and he works on internet freedom. He will be delivering keynote address. I welcome you, sir. Mr. Triveni Singh, who is SP, and he looks after the cyber cell, and he knows the side of law and technology. Professor Sanjay Singh, Dr. P.K. Gautam, I welcome you. And Aniket, Yakub, Sakshi, Abhinav, and all other members of the committee, I welcome you all. Without your support, it was not possible to hold this seminar in a very important topic, law and technology. I can recall that when first cloning was done, I think the sheep, there were certain issues which were raised in the legal arena also, and they were ethico-legal issues, whether it is ethical or not to get a clone of a sheep. And this can happen with Homo sapiens, with human beings also. So what law can do about that? We know about clinical trials also, how they can be legally controlled. Now telemedicine has come, and then the operations, that is the medical procedures, can be operated from USA and the patient is in Pakistan. So if something goes wrong, then who will be responsible for that, whether the hospital in Pakistan or the surgeon? These are the issues which we have to deal with, because the legal provisions are now not adequate. Then in business also, you know, a new thing has come up now. It is not that new. Cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, blockchain technology, e-commerce. And then cartels are being formed, monopolistic cartels, they are being formed. And they operate beyond national boundaries. How e-commerce can be regulated when we know that it is beyond the national boundaries? Then there are certain privacy issues also. This Aadhaar has come, and people are concerned about it. And then, you know, recently during COVID-19, we had to download, at least the government servants, Aarogya Setu. And in Uttar Pradesh, there is Ayush Kavach also. So how much data we deliver to them and how do they use it? nobody knows. Then aerial surveillance through drones. And during COVID-19, it was done because there were news that there were some people who were not following the COVID-19 lockdown. That is another issue. Then internet shutdown, whether there is any right to internet or not. And when internet is shut down, then it affects your freedom of speech and expression. And businesses also, because you cannot get into the financial transactions. These are important things, and we are still debating data protection bill, from where we should copy it. So there are so many issues which have come up in recent times. OTT, nobody had heard about it. OTT is there, that social media, it has become so powerful that it disseminates all the news, and everything is done on social media. How to control it? Then cyber crimes are taking place because of lockdown. The people were not getting to the banks. Physically, they could not be present. So cyber crimes there was a spate in cyber crimes, pornography. There are so many issues which will be covered during these 2 days. So in the end, I must congratulate the committee, members of the committee, convener, co-convener, joint convener, and all members, and the chairperson of the seminar committee, Dr. P.K. Gautam, that they made it possible. And I wish our deliberations will be very, very useful, because you have experts from different fields. Academicians are there. Professor Tabriz is there. Then advocates are there. That Mr. Apar Gupta is here. He is executive director of Internet Freedom. And then from police also, Mr. Triveni Singh is there. And then there will be more in the business sessions. So I wish that this particular seminar becomes very successful, and we find out some meaningful conclusions and suggestions also. Thank you very much.
I would like to join the guest of honor, Professor Triveni Singh, to kindly say a few words. Sir.
Yeah, how much time you are giving me? How much time? Hello?
Dr. P.K. Gautam, please tell how much time you are going to give to each and every speaker. That
Sir, you can take, sir, 10 to 15 minutes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. First, let me introduce myself. I'm SP Cybercrime of Uttar Pradesh, and currently I'm looking into 50,000 plus cases. Remember the figure, 50,000 plus cybercrime cases currently I am looking, that's on my table. So you can imagine the magnitude and dimension of the cybercrime. Earlier, rarely used, 2, 3, 4 cases used to come on our table. Now, for the last 2 years, there is a crowd, you know, in front of the cybercrime police station. So my account is hacked, my wallet is hacked. Somebody has created my fake profile. Somebody has hacked my mail ID. Some corporate sector is coming, sir. They have hacked into my database. They have siphoned away all my, accounts. I mean, corporate accounts. And there is a data breach cases. There is a ransomware attack. So somebody is coming, sir. My crypto wallet is wiped out. Somebody is coming, sir, there are lots of fake crypto mining operators are into the market, and they are mining fake cryptocurrency. Somebody telling, sir, there is a fake crypto exchange operating, fake company operating. Somebody is coming, sir, my fingerprint clone has been created. Someone else is coming, he says, sir, my debit card cloned, my credit card cloned, identity cloned. Recently, we got many more cases in which by using deepfake technology, they are creating your synthetic identity. And you cannot differentiate without using the forensic tool. You cannot differentiate between the synthetic identity of yours and the original one, you know. So each and everyone is having 2, 3 identity. Number one, a physical identity, that's I'm sitting in front of you. And then my virtual identity. that I have created, and then the synthetic identity that has been created by the criminals. So for police department or for legal fraternity, it's a challenge. So now knowledge of technology is not choice. It's not option. It's mandatory. It's only option. So whether you want to be a cyber lawyer, whether you want to be a technology lawyer or not, it's not an option. You are supposed to know technology, otherwise you will be good for nothing before court, because each and every crime is somehow in 90% cases cyber angle is involved, and then the electronic evidence. So no longer, gone are the days when you used to get your witnesses in the court and they used to speak for or against. Now the entire case is dependent upon electronic evidence. Then the whole domain of cyber forensic is coming. So what is cyber forensic? It's not something just you can learn in 2, 3, 4, 15 days. It's an entire course. And my personal suggestion is that there should be a 3 months course in each college and university in law courses, because your evidence is entirely in electronic mode. So how to acquire the data, how to make an image, then how to do the analysis, then how to create the report, how to preserve the evidences, how to produce in the court, how to prove the authenticity of the electronic documents. It's all technical. And if as a lawyer you don't understand this cyber forensic, I can say with guarantee that you are going to fail at this stage of trial. You know. So it's mandatory to know the technology. So what is technology? As Vice Chancellor has said, there is a blockchain, there is lots of technology, artificial intelligence, machine learning, then everything is a company owner, you know, a big multinational company owner said that in world, each and every company is software company, be it automobile company, be it somebody is into an aircraft manufacturing, or a cloth making company, would say, is each and every company is software company. You are driving a car, it's completely a software enabled car. So if there is software, then each and there is every possibility that anyone can hack into, because software enabled. So every corporate is hackable, your car is hackable, your this computer system right now we are sitting, we are interacting with, it's hackable. Then once it has been hacked, then there is a cyber crime. And when there will be crime, you know, there will be a cyber liar or a liar for that matter. So crime and liar, prosecution section, it's inter Europe. It's main ye kehta hu ki ek hi sikke ke do pahlu hain. So all crime is technology crime. So I need a liar who is smart in understanding the law, and he should be not master, but he should be at least aware about the technology, developing technology. So I always say that a lawyer is supposed to be good at IS auditing, information security auditing, cyber forensic. He must be a little bit aware about hardware, software, programming. If he knows a bit about programming, if he knows a bit about source code, then he can better argue the court, his case in the court. And that's why you see those lawyers are the most highly paid who are the technically sound. So now this is the age of technology lawyer. Now this is the age of cyber lawyer. So I always advise each and everyone, be it faculty members, be it students, anyone who is related with, you know, the court, then he's supposed to be knowledgeable about this technology thing. And how can we learn? It's not a matter of doing some course. I always suggest just Google everything, whatever is coming, you just Google something. What is behind the scene? And behind the scene is always technology. So I always suggest just you be the master, and only then you can be a successful liar. It's my message to students, it's my message to faculty, it's my message to whosoever, be it a police officer or liar or prosecutors, Because there is a huge domain emerging right now, you know, litigation support. And litigation support is nothing but social media analysis. There's some analysis on big data platform, and then you can support your case and you can win and lose the battle on the basis of this litigation support. That is entirely based on your knowledge of technology and analysis, artificial intelligence use and all that. So technology is the key. That's my final message. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now, I would like to invite the head of department, Professor Dr. Sanjay Singh, to kindly say a few words.
Thank you, Abhinav. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia National Law University, Professor Tabriz Ahmed, Dr. Gautam, and one more expert, I'm not getting his name. So by movement, Dr. Gautam has provided me this opportunity. I thought that I'm the layman as far as the whole cyberspace is concerned, then how to take up the things. So whatever is the notion, in fact, as far as society is concerned, there are three important variables to that. One, the ideological aspect. Another, the technological aspect. And the third, the organizational aspect. If you take the topic of the today's seminar, that is law and technology, issues and perspective, two components, they are there. Technological component, that's there. Organizational component, law is there. But what about the ideological component? What about the philosophical aspect of the whole issue that is absent, in fact? So my suggestion would be to the organizers that please incorporate this ideological issues also, because they are very important, in fact. And when you perceive any social order, then ideology is important. This ideology, in fact, affects the technology and how to take the ideology, technology, along with other components of the society, you need the organizational component. And where law is all very, very important. So in each and every society, if you take, in fact, if you take the human history, and just I take the very simple example of the Marxian notion, where what he says, only the first society that we can perceive is a classless society, where the role of the technology is minimum, or more or the less, that technology is available to all. Whatever is there, whatever life chances, they're also equal to all. But after that, one by one, the moment you come to the present day capitalist society, what you get, that technology is not favoring all. To a certain extent, there is a class divide also. But that's not my concern. In fact, what I want to emphasize is that in 1970s and onwards, there was a debate, and that debate was initiated by Daniel Bell, and he's saying the post-industrial society. The moment he's talking about post-industrial society, he's emphasizing upon the information society. Society where information is important. Society where data is important. Society where processing of that data is important. Society where after collecting data, after processing that data, how we are going to implement that is more important. But the question is, who do have that data, who is processing that data, and how that data is going to have impact on the broader society, this is very important. From that point, in fact, from 70s onwards, in fact, the moment we realize that something post-industrial is there, information is there, and how that information is going to control, how that information is going to have a very different new society, that's all important. I'm not going to give you anything, in fact, but what I want to initiate with a proper dialogue, and that particular dialogue, I'm taking it from a very important social thinker, and that debate is quite open, Manuel Kessel. When Manuel Kessel takes up the present day social order and what he says, this is very important. And what he's saying, society and technology is going through a structural change. And in that structural change, the information is all very important. Now, the question is, the basis of social connections, in fact, they change the logic of the network. The whole drama of the social relationship, in fact, that's changing due to who do have, in fact, control over the network. Then the power in network is determined by the ability to find, hold, and process information. No doubt that highway is there, but who controls that, who processes that, who gives the information, who controls and holds the information, they are very important, in fact, what he says. The politics and power equations also changed. And one very important question, in fact, that was initiated from the writings of Max Weber to Habermas, he is taking that question once again. When the sovereignty of the state was questioned by Max Weber, Habermas provided an answer with a notion of legitimacy. But here, once again, Manuel Kessel is coming up with a proposition where what he says that the sovereignty of state is also deconstructed by the importance of global flow of economy. And as a result of this, the legitimacy of the state is challenged. The belief of citizens in the traditional democracy is questioned, and the present case, the Shadavi case, we can take it as a small example to the whole debate, what's going on. Not only that, Manuel Kessel is also talking about three important identities. One, legitimating identity, one, resistance, and the project. Both legitimating and the project identity is well within the domain of what you call it as a sovereign state. But with the advent of the network society, what's very important, the resistance identity that is there is not at all under the control of any state. It's very much individualized and anonymous. As a result of this, number of notions, number of questions, they are there. How to take up this? Where, which particular law you are talking about? Which particular state we are talking about? And who is going to take care of what? That's very important. And that's why, if I conclude, in fact, just it was a notion I wanted to just throw it to you so that the people may ponder upon that. The modern law, even when it is formally enacted by political authority and enforced accordingly, also requires popular legitimacy in order to be recognized as valid among the subjects of law. Now the question is whether that subjects of law in the network society, they are committed to any nation state or not. This is a big question. And in this particular background, we'll have to take recourse to the present day debate of law vis-a-vis technology. Without taking that background, whatever discussions we are going to have, maybe they are going to give us relief for certain time period, relief for a particular context. But as far as the universal issues and problems are concerned, they are not going to be settled. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your wise words. Now, I would like to invite the chairperson of our committee, Dr. Prem Kumar Gautam, to kindly say a few words, sir.
Thank you, Abhinav. Respected Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Dr. Arman Eliu, Professor Dr. S. Patnagar, respected Chief Guest Professor Dr. Tabdeep Ahmed, Vice Chancellor G.T. Goenka University, Gurugram, Haryana. Respected guest of honor, Sri Trivini Singh, Superintendent of Police, Cyber Cell, UPPLS. Respected keynote speaker, Advocate Apar Gupta. Executive Director, Internet Freedom Foundation. Respected Head of the Department, Dr. Armin Ali, Professor Dr. Sindhya Singh. Distinguished faculty members, student participants, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to express my gratitude and warmly welcome you all on behalf of the seminar committee in 2 days virtual seminar on the theme Law and Technology. On the occasion, we are honored to have with us renowned speakers from the academia, administration, and the bar. As you are aware that the evolution of technology in the modern digital world has transformed the way individuals communicate, learn, and how institutions function. Therefore, we are witnessing new legal issues emerging from the interface between the law and technology. In today's world, specifically after the COVID-19 pandemic, technology has penetrated almost all the areas of our daily life, like entertainment, healthcare, education, communication, economy, etc. Technology does not remain only a product of processing in industry or advancement of communication. In today's world, it is a part of social process which affects social relationship, methods of communication, behavior patterns, and laws. Considering the evolution of technology and its impact on our human life, lawmaking bodies, and our regulatory design, we are organizing this seminar to facilitate the exchange of ideas. Based on these ideas, we have incorporated several themes under the seminar. I would like to put forth before our guests and the participants that we have received around 90 abstracts, out of which we selected 60 abstracts for the full paper. We received abstracts majorly on following sub-themes that includes the data protection, right to privacy, state surveillance, internet shutdown, and freedom of speech, regulation of OTT platforms, fintech, and cryptocurrency. I hope the presenters who will be presenting in the technical sessions will shed some better light on these issues. In this seminar, we finally received 25 papers adhering to the submission guidelines. At the preliminary stage, the assistant editors reviewed the papers and shortlisted the best 16 papers, which were forwarded to senior editors for stage 2 review. The best 10 papers will be published in an edited book. I thank all the editors for providing their valuable insights and assistance in selecting the manuscripts. In the last, but not the least, I wish to express my gratitude to all the faculty advisors and seminar committee members for their full cooperation and support in organizing this seminar. I wish a very fruitful and productive seminar to all. Thank you.
By the keynote speaker for today's event, Advocate Abhar Gupta, to kindly say a few words, sir.
Thank you so much for extending this very warm invitation to me for delivering this keynote speech. The title of my speech is New Worlds, But Old Principles, Democratic Values Rooted in India. And I'm picking up this topic, which may seem a bit distant from technology, because one of the first courses which is taught in law school is jurisprudence. It is a fundamental approach to how we study law. And jurisprudence, when it's broken down as per its dictionary definition, means the philosophy of law. But what is the philosophy of technology? And this is very important for us all to consider, especially rooted within Indian traditions and what has been our learning throughout. So let me just start with something which has personally influenced me tremendously, which is Gandhiji's Hind Swaraj. Written in 1909, when he was on a steamboat coming back from Great Britain in a manic stage of about 2 weeks, written by hand by Mr. Gandhi, it devotes an entire chapter on technology, in which he critiques technology because of its modernity and its reliance on Western industrialization, which is wreaking havoc all over the world. You can understand his perspective because India is a colony in which technology has been used to oppress us as natives by a colonial power. But you must also understand his perspective as an English educated barrister who has seen the hand spinning looms in Manchester be completely destroyed by the power looms which they are there. Now, today when we wear refined cotton, it is very well and proper for us to take these benefits and question this Gandhian philosophy, right? After all, our practice is conflicting with these high ideals. But how is it reconciled? I think here lies an important lesson. And that lesson is of social control. When the power looms first came in, they were cold fired. They resulted in ash completely destroying the local ecology. They resulted in a high amount of industrialization, providing employment, but taking away employment from people. And they also resulted in a huge amount of industrial accidents. What is the purpose law fulfilled there? Let us step back. What do you think the laws which came in there? If you go through your labor codes, it was the Boilers Act to actually mandate that the harmful effects of industrialization are not caused to people who are should be the beneficiaries of them. And the people who should be beneficiaries of them are quite often people who are not like Apar Gupta, who's a privileged English educated affluent lawyer. It is the person who works and produces that cotton, right? You had environmental protection which came in for the air, for the water. And our own experiments in India with industrialization have shown that these are imperfect negotiations. They will always keep taking place. Because development is necessary for people to be employed. But at the same point in time, law is necessary for that development to be within a social framework. I was listening with great interest the address of the Superintendent of Police Cybercrime as he was stating that with growth in internet access, there are close to 50,000 cybercrimes. Why is this happening? This is happening because crime is a social problem. And why is the crime increasing? Crime is increasing because India today has close to, as per TRAI data, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, in its latest report says, close to 700 million active internet connections. In fact, in a place like Delhi, the tele density for active broadband connections is somewhat of 3:1. So there are three connections of one person. But it also poses a deeper challenge of disparity. For instance, in certain states such as Bihar, it is so deficient that there is a tele density of 40 per 100, which means that not even 4 out of 10 people will have internet access. If we take that figure as being 1:1, which is not often the case, sometimes it's 1:5. Given how many devices we have, or 1:3 or 1:2. Now, let's come to much more practical aspects. What does this mean? And how do we apply these learnings to our daily lives? Well, we reject modernity and Western industrialization. We need to root it in our constitutional ideals, which what becomes very important, and I think forms a broad part of the papers which will be discussed throughout this seminar. Students here will actively debate what are the contours of our constitutional framework, our fundamental rights, directive principles of state policy, as they are advanced through technology, as they are also limited by technology. And I would think all stakeholders here, whether they be from government, private industry, academia, technologists, need to integrate a greater sense of a constitutional vision in all of our work. And I think they already do so. But we are all human, we are all imperfect. And what do we gain by these seminars? We gain a diversity of thought, debate, and ultimately a wide latitude to disagree. And when we disagree, it is not as if we are making a final call. We may write whatever we want, but we should have the humility of knowing that our word is not the last word and our truths are never complete. And this is what guides our work at the Internet Freedom Foundation itself. It is very incumbent today, as we are using social media platforms, that we approach social media with the same Gandhian outlook of diversity, of tolerance, of what he calls as prem, which I think never perfectly translates to English as love or affection. Prem means that we all as human beings within India recognize that we are different, but we are working towards a constitutional vision in different ways. There will be crime, there will be social problems, and the only way to overcome that will not only be through policing and certainty of punishment or penalty, but will be through a greater degree of curiosity, thought, and conversation. And this is what social media quite often does not permit us to do. It withers away at our patience. It builds a velocity of information in which we need to exchange information at all points in time. It prioritizes through its algorithms more and more polarity, which means either you're on the left or you're on the right, and people in the center are getting boxed and are getting called out all of a sudden. Well, that center sometimes is something which is inconvenient, but that center by itself can also be a rights-based center. It can be also something which can be irrespective of a person's political ideology, as much as it can follow it as well, either to the right and the left. And this is the breadth provided by the Indian Constitution. So it is with this degree of debate we reach a constitutional goal. In fact, when the Constitution was being adopted and was being framed, the inaugural address of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was to make all members of the Constituent Assembly sign on to what is called the Oath of the Tennis Court. The Oath of the Tennis Court is essentially that all of us are engaged in a game of tennis, and it is incumbent on us as players to hit the ball back to the other person. We may hit it with some aggression, okay, but we have to keep playing with each other because we are all part of this country and we are all playing a beautiful game in which we are hoping to advance our constitutional ideals. Much more tangibly, speaking to the role technology plays in our life today, in our own work, and if we look at specifically in the form of litigation, we need to rely and integrate other faculties and rely on what is called by several of our professors and colleagues who will be there, who keep stating that we need to be interdisciplinary in our approach. This is the same thing also which was indicated by the superintendent of police. Whereas lawyers may all not be able to be technically adept, may not all know programming, what we need to do is carry a degree of humility to know that we are not the experts in technology and then seek out that expertise. In fact, in our own work at the Internet Freedom Foundation, we do it quite often. For instance, just in the case with respect to encryption, in a pending litigation, which was initially there before the Madras High Court and then got transferred to the Supreme Court, concerning the curious issue of traceability and how can misinformation, which gives rise to a lot of law and order concerns, even resulting in loss of life and property, can we geotag and identify messages through that? And what impacts that has on privacy? Of course, as a lawyer, I'll have my opinion about it, but is this technically possible? Am I, Apar Gupta, the right person to answer this question? I would venture not, which is why we reached out to Professor Manoj Prabhakaran, who chairs cryptography at IIT Bombay. Or if I have an opinion about contact tracing apps and their effectiveness in terms of deployment of Bluetooth technology, what is the system design around it? How effective will it be? What are the trade-offs against privacy, given that privacy is never as absolute as much as lawyers and organizations such as IFF try to realize its full potential? Whether there'll be very practical barriers to how much information needs to be gathered and what purposes need to be played by the state in achievement of its objectives here of greater promotion of health and impediments which need to be placed in the pandemic, which has forced this conference also to be online. Here we sought expertise of Professor Subhashish Banerjee, another IIT professor who is there in IIT Delhi. Thereby, I would encourage that future conferences, and I will leave it with this parting thought, also need to be open and should possibly explore being co-hosted with other academic institutions which are much more technically centered. So from the high philosophy of Gandhi to the much more practical urge for further conferences in this regard, which integrate with other faculties of sciences and technology. I would leave this address. I have much to learn, and I look forward to much to learning, not only from the faculty here, but from the students, because it is the students here, I think so, those who have invested months and weeks and days and hours and their weekends of their time writing these papers, I know that I will learn. They are the people who I think are digital natives, have grown up with technology, grown up with access, and have a core commitment to the constitutional values and advancing Gandhi's vision of a Hind Swaraj. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your insight. Thank you so much. Now, I would like to invite our chief guest, Professor Dr. Tabriz Ahmed, to kindly say a few words. Sir, over to you.
So, I think the base are disconnected. Abhinav, just check.
Yes, there is some internet issue. No, sir, he's back, I guess. He's back. He's among the participants.
Sir,
Professor Tabriz has joined again. Please.
Sir, I would like to invite our chief guest, Professor Dr. Tabriz Ahmed, to kindly say a few words.
Okay, thank you. Let me thank Dr. S. K. Bhatnagar for inviting this program. And also let me congratulate the committee of the seminar and conference at the Ramana Lohia for taking great initiative to have a very important program on that law and technology and perspectives, because rightly said by the different speakers, Dr. Bhatnagar, Tribeni Singh, Swapar Gupta, and several speakers spoke about different perspectives of the law and technology. Because very wide area and also the wide perspective, talk about the human rights, talk about the fundamental rights, or the e-commerce, m-commerce, or it has a very wide perspective, because this area belongs to everybody. And everybody is getting affected. So if you talk about the development of the law and technology, if you talk about the 1990s, we have seen the mobile phone coming, and then we had only a chance to do send messages because there was the 1G technology. Then we have seen 1990, we got 2G technology where you can send messages, and also you have the calling over the mobile phone. Then we have seen 3G coming in 2000, where you can send messages, you can do calling, also you can do video streaming. And 4G came in 2010, where we can also have the live video webcasting and telecasting. But the greatest challenge is because of the 5G technology in 2020. Because 5G is bringing a lot of revolution of the data processing, data sharing, or data development. And then because now the data is the big asset, data is new oil, and refined data is refined oil. We have now IoT, we have now the blockchain technology, we have cryptocurrency. And also we have the biggest challenge, how we're going to control data, because data is flowing throughout the world. And as per the Sanjay Singh was mentioning about that ideology about, and also is talking about the international perspective. Because if you ask my opinion, it is not a local issue, because you just go for paying for a small buying by the credit card, your information is flowing maybe several countries within a few seconds. So that's why it is not a very local issue. It is a global issue. And you talk about the crime, crime is generally a kind of the state subject, but the boundary of the crime is cyber crime is a global boundary. So that's why this requires a lot of planning, lot of coordination, not at local level, but international level. Then we are going to regulate the crimes very nicely, because as Tribeni Singh is my good friend, and we know each other from several years because we are from same field of the cyber crime and cyber law. He quoted that he has 50,000 cases to handle. See, only one state in the country, 50,000 cases. If you talk about the global cases, and all these cases are coming every day, a new kind of innovative cases. The forms are changing, and those the cyber criminals becoming smarter, smarter day by day. They are going to use new technology. If you talk about the pandemic, it has grown 3 times than the normal conditions. And also it has the kind of the reasons, because all those normal criminals, they used to do crime, petty crimes locally. Once everything was shut down, they have gone to the online and trying to do a lot of crimes. And also because we have shifted our offline to the online medium, then we are having the greatest kind of the vulnerability to be caught by or approached by the cyber criminals. So my point is that because the shift from 1G technology to 5G technology, and then because the biggest challenge is regarding this electronic evidences and regulatory aspect. Currently, if you see this, only 1% is the conviction rate in cybercrime. While if you talk about the normal crimes, it is going to be around 65%. So now it is heaven for all the criminals, because why they will do offline crime where conviction chances is 65%. They will be definitely going to the online crimes or cyber crime where chances for conviction just 1%. And also we know very well, even in 1%, it is very big challenge to raise the conviction rate, because very rightly mentioned by the Mr. Tribeni Singh regarding the challenges for electronic evidences. If you talk about the our police station, very few police station is high tech police station where if any crime is committed, can our police go and make a raid to any computer center or any person's mobile phone, or they are so sophisticated, smart enough to get data from the mobile phone or collect data from the computer center? Because you know the process of the CRPC, it is a very long process. Then you have to prove your case beyond reasonable doubt. Then you are going to convict or going to punish the cyber criminal. Also, it has a lot of challenge for awareness. Sometime if you go and file an FIR, police generally take your case mostly in the normal IPC than the IT Act. Because sometime lack of the awareness of the person filing the FIR, and sometime lack of awareness of the police taking the FIR, and sometime because it is a pressure on the investigation officer to investigate the crime under the IT Act, he requires a lot of sophisticated skill, lot of instrument to collect data, produce data, and also bring the data to the court to prove the case. And also now it is reflecting the challenges for the high-tech court. Very less court in the country which are high-tech court, where you are able to produce your data and showcase the judge and prove beyond the doubt. Because Tribeni Singh mentioned that there are a lot of people are going to create synthetic information, synthetic credit card, synthetic identity problems. In the synthetic creation, unless you have forensic science tools, and then only tools will be able to identify whether it was a fake data or it was a real data. In that case, because if you talk about the cost-wise, forensic tools are very, very costly. And also it required a lot of training to handle those tools. It is very costly to manage those tools. Can our police stations, can our police will be able to manage these tools? So my point is that it's a very serious problem. If you talk about the ideology level, talk about the enforcement law level, talk about the making the law level, and talk about the coordination at global level. And the way it is growing is a serious concern for everybody, because everybody is now prone to cybercrime, because the way the market is changing, everybody has a mobile phone. Almost in the phone, mobile phone numbers are more than the citizens. So this means that in going forward, everybody is prone to cybercrime. That's why awareness is very important, legal policy making very important, and enforcement of law very important, training to police, and also regarding cybercrime convictions regarding the technology development and all very important. in the 5G perspective, because at every 250 meter there will be an access center and it will be a two-way traffic, because we are expecting the kind of the without kind of the pilot cars, these auto run cars and two-way traffic. This is going to be serious problem in the future. That's why it requires a lot of thought process for everybody, for policy makers to make law properly, to make awareness. And I must thank the Ramanan Lohia for taking very important initiative to talk on this point, have a debate on this point. I'm sure the outcome will be great support for policy makers and for raising the conviction in cyber crime. With these few words, I thank you all of you. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your insight. Now, I would like to invite the joint convener of our committee, Ms. Sakshi Agarwal, for delivering the vote of thanks. Over to you, Sakshi.
Thank you, Abhinav. It is my honor to extend thankful gratitude to all the esteemed dignitaries present today. I would like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Subhiket Bhatnagar, for constant motivation and guiding us and giving us an opportunity to organize such an event under his aegis. I thank our chief guest, Dr. Professor Tabriz Ahmed, for gracing the event and highlighting the major challenges in the adjudication of cyber crimes. I thank our guest of honor, Professor Tribhuvan Singh, for sparing his valuable time and presenting before us a thoughtful message for the legal fraternity. I thank Advocate Apar Gupta for enlightening us with his words of wisdom and giving a constitutional vision on the theme of the seminar. I thank our head of department, Dr. Sanjay Singh, for sharing his valuable inputs. We shall consider incorporating the ideological component in the later course of the discussion. Thank you, sir, for this suggestion. Lastly, I thank our chairperson, Dr. Prem Kumar Gautam, for guiding us and assisting us at every step. My biggest thanks to all the participants for taking interest in the event and successfully submitting the manuscripts. I thank all my committee members for standing by me throughout, and I wish them all the luck for this event. Thank you all for joining.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, distinguished speakers.
Thank you, Sakshi. Now, this brings us towards the end of the ceremony. I would like to thank all of you for attending this event. The National Seminar is first such attempt by the committee. We are looking forward to your feedback and suggestion. See you all at your respective technical sessions. Thank you so much.
Thank you all of you.
Thank you, Professor Tabriz, Mr. and Apar Gupta.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Gautam, for invitation.
Thank you, Tabriz, sir. Thank you, Mrs. sir.
Thank you.
Thank you all.